saints and friends.
Good morning.
This is the first Sunday of Advent.
Yeah.
And before you know it, we'll be through with the year 2023. God has been good.
Amen.
And all the time, God is good. Let us stand to our feet as we come together. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Liturgist, and afterwards you will direct us in the Advent light.
Well, first I'm going to say, go ahead and sit down. This is going to be a while before you need to be standing again, so go ahead and sit down. I'd like to welcome you all here to Fair Oaks United Methodist Church, and we come together as our loving group to worship our Heavenly Father. Please take a minute or two to sign in the red folders at the end of your aisle so we can keep track of our attendance. And I wanted to make a couple of real quick announcements. There's a church council meeting after church today, and there's a charge conference on the 10th, that's next week. It's at 12:30, and between the end of church and the 12:30 start time, we're going to have a potluck. So if you get to eat, you're Methodists, it's all about the food. And so there's a sign up. You can either sign up, it's going to be up here, or there's another sign up in the narthex on the little brown table right as you leave the sanctuary. And so you can sign up for what you're bringing for a charge conference, and we'll have that together. And I think that is all. So we're going to begin with our candle. Okay, to light our candle, we begin. In the days of exile and uncertainty, the prophet Isaiah cried out, "Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil, come down to make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you."
In the midst of our own encounters with uncertainty and upheaval, and our longing for deliverance, Jesus called to us, "Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come."
We wait as people, surprised again and again by God, who shakes us out of our complacency and wakes us up to the roar of the kingdom around us. We light this candle as a sign of our shocking hope.
We'd like to invite Jose up to come up and to light our candle.
Ven aquí.
How do you say purple? Push in.
We light this candle as a sign of our shocking hope. May we stay awake to God.
Opening hymn this morning, being the first Sunday of the month, down at the cross. Glory to his name. Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. You may stand and please.
Praise the Lord, my brothers and my sisters. It is so good to once again be in the house of the Lord. I'm so glad also we Jose is with us and Freddie Marr is with us and yes, thank God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise God for their presence. Yes. And then we have also three special guests. First, I want to introduce the couple that lives right around the corner, and I'm forgetting his name. Tom. How can I forget Tom? Yes. And I met his wife this morning, and so it is so nice to have you. We praise God for you, and we pray that our service will be spiritually rewarding, and you will indeed come back again to worship with us. And then we have another visitor that I'm surprised, a good friend. She is a presiding elder of the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church. Amen. And it is so good. It is so good to see you, Reverend Gloria Clemens White. And if there's anything you'd like to say, we certainly welcome you to say anything.
It's just that I'm very glad to be here today. I thank God for the opportunity to celebrate the first Sunday in Advent with all of you. I am truly, truly blessed. This first Sunday is my favorite Sunday because it's Holy Communion Sunday.
Yes.
And I could not be at my church, but I couldn't think of a better place to be than here.
Yes.
Amen.
Welcome. Yes. And Presiding Elder Gloria Clemens White lives close. She doesn't live too far, but even though she's Presiding Elder, she also serves as pastor. Is that still right?
No, I'm not pastoring. I'm just Presiding Elder.
You just, okay. Praise the Lord. Amen. So we're so glad that you are here with us. One of the things that I also wanted to, as you sign in, we need to know birthdays. And so beginning next month, we want to, in fact, we'll do it today for those who are here, those who have birthdays on in the various months, we want to know so that we can celebrate them. And so if there's any birthdays in January, I'm already in January. So if there are any birthdays in December, we'd like for you to stand and we'll sing happy birthday.
We forgot November. We didn't do any birthdays in November. My husband just had his birthday in November.
Okay, well let's do November. See, we have to have everybody's name. All right. So November and December, please stand. All right. So, Matt, what are you, November or December?
November 27th.
Okay, just last week.
Yep.
All right. Praise the Lord.
Almost.
Adrian?
November 4th.
All right. Praise the Lord. No December, baby. Okay. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Let us continue our worship service with our prayer hymn, Spirit of the Living God.
Thank you.
Christian song, so you can get the real meaning of what we're singing. We want the Spirit of God to fall fresh on us each and every time we come together. Someone asked, what is the church? One definition is, when the believers come together, they come together in such a way, they love the Lord so much, and when we see each other, we set each other on fire. That's the church. I trust and pray that when you came this morning, you had the fire of Pentecost. When you saw me and I saw you, we set each other aflame, and that's the church. Does that make sense? We love the Lord so much, hallelujah, that when we come together, we just charge each other up. That's why I can't wait to come get here on Sunday morning. In spite of this marathon this morning, it didn't stop none of us from getting here. Didn't have to break no rules, cross no lines, but we made it anyhow. And we thank the Lord. Thank those that in shape run 25 miles. 20 who?
22.
It's more than that?
Yeah.
Some are walking out there, and that's what I've been doing about this time. Praise the Lord. Believe it or not, I used to be a distance runner in high school and college. I don't even like to walk anymore, so praise the Lord. We have an addition to our prayer list. We thank God for what he's already been doing with our prayer list. So we continue to trust and believe in the power of prayer. In spite of releasing hostages and having a dry run at Cedar Park, I understand as of this morning, close to 200 folks have been killed again since the startup of the fighting. God is still in control, and we trust and believe that everything is going to eventually be all right. We pray for the family of Sister Alejandro. Pray for Raven Steinbach and Sister Nancy Kay, Sister Wendy. Thank God for how he's yet blessing Brother Bill. Pray for Ada R. and Ben C. I understand Ben and his wife were here for the homegoing on Friday. We thank God for what you're doing in his body. Pray for Sharon J. Betty S., her granddaughter Raven. Pray for Sue E. and Ruth G. and Linda R. Loretta D. Continue to pray for Carol and Paul. Pray for Wendy's son, Tony. Continue to pray for Eric, Janine's son, Hubby Now. Continue to pray for Roseanne's sister, Michelle. Pray for Benji's husband, Roy. Continue to pray for Cameron as he continues to believe in a cancer-free body. Continued prayer for Sherry J., Brother Mark, John, Cheryl, Lawrence, Hayes, and Cheryl family, and also their cousin, Barry Williams. Special prayer for Barry's wife, Shirley. Continued to pray for Dave's mother and Kathy's mother. Pray for Renee's mother, Ruby W., Patty. Pray for Betty S.'s granddaughter. Continue to pray, believe you, for healing touch for our son, Charles Dixon Law. Pray for Cynthia's friend, daughter Megan, who was recently diagnosed with uterine cancer. And let's pray for Nancy Edwards' family. We trust, believe that God will do anything that we ask in His name. He's inclined to hear our prayer, never turns a deaf ear to us. And we believe Him for the answer of prayer. Praise God. Father, we want to come to you now, thanking you for what you've already done. You've been good to us. You've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. And we thank you for being a constant companion with us. You walk with us, you talk with us, and you remind us that we're yet your own. And we thank you for it. You didn't abandon us, you did not leave us as orphans, but you said you'd be with us until the end of the age. And we believe you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. We thank you, Lord, that you're able to meet the needs of each one of us. We call on you at any time, 24/7, and you're always present. And you're inclined to hear us. And you tend to our needs, and we thank you for it. Oh, Lord, you're such a big God. You're the kind of God that you're God everywhere. You're God all by yourself. You're in the Middle East. You're in Ukraine. You're in the Near East, the Far East. You're here in the United States. You're everywhere people are. And we thank you for it. For you created this place. And you still are in control in spite of what we think. But we believe you, Lord, that we can ask anything in your name. And it shall be granted unto us. So, Lord, we thank you for answered prayer. We thank you, O God, that you're able to do more than we would think or ask. We thank you, Lord, that in our dire needs, you're always there to respond to our cry. And you let us know that you will not pass us by. So we thank you. We thank you, O God, that you're able to touch each one on this prayer list. You've been doing it. You're still in the blessing business. And we sense, oh God, a miracle taking place in the lives and the minds and the bodies of each one of these on our prayer list. And we thank you in advance for it. We thank you, oh God, that you're never too tired. You never take a recess. You never take a vacation. You never take a day off. But you're with us 24/7. And we thank you for it. We can always depend upon you, oh Lord. And we can always look to the hill from which cometh our help, knowing our help cometh from you. And we just say thank you some more. If we had 10,000 tongues to say thank you, it wouldn't be sufficient enough. But you know the sentiments of our hearts. You know how our attitudes, what we sense, what we feel in our mind, in our spirit, in our hearts. You know, God, we love you. And we thank you for loving us first. In Jesus' name. Oh God, continue, oh God, to bless, even right now as we begin this time of Advent, first Sunday of Advent, time, oh Lord, that we anticipate the coming of the Christ child, as we commemorate over 2,000 years ago, that you sent your only begotten Son, and we thank you, Lord, for the Son, Jesus Christ, who has raised each one of us up to be above and beyond what we thought we could be. And we thank you, O Lord, for giving us the inspiration, renewing our faith, giving to us, O Lord, the kind of power, the dunamis, O God, the power of the Holy Spirit to survive and to live out our lives and to glorify and to magnify your holy name. So we thank you for that ability. We thank you, O Lord, for placing desire in our hearts, knowing that we want to be more like you. And we thank you for it. Be with us, O God, continuously as we prepare, as we close in on the end of this year. And as we look back over our lives, where would we be without you being on our side? So we thank you, O God, in the name of Jesus we pray. Be with us now as we continue this time of worship, touching the pastor afresh, anoint her, sanctify her, and give her, functionize her spirit, and give her the dunamis power to be able to proclaim the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ that sets us free, that delivers us, and that, oh God, picks us up and turns us around. And because of you, we're on the street called Spring. We thank you. Bless us now. Have your way as we continue in this service, as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those trespassing against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. We have our children here. Praise God.
Our children can go to Sunday school today. I love saying that. That's one of my favorite things to say in church. Our kids can go to Sunday school. Our first scripture reading is from the Old Testament, Isaiah 64, verses 1 through 9. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when the fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversary, so the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, nor ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities like wind take us away. There is no one who calls on your name, or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay and you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people.
New Testament lesson for the morning is found in Mark 13, chapter 24 to 27 verses. Coming of the Son of Man. But in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather the elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
Praise his holy name. Monica Hill this morning will be led by the Senior Choir, O Come.
Oh, God, remember.
come. Oh, come. Emmanuel. Father God, you are welcome in this place. Take me and fill me with your spirit, oh God. Fill this waiting congregation. In the mighty name of Jesus, and let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And the people of God said, Amen, God, Amen. My brothers and my sisters in Christ and creation, as we've already indicated, today is the first Sunday of Advent, a time when we not only begin to focus on Jesus' first coming, but we also look forward to the coming of Jesus again. Advent season is more than hanging the greens, decorating the church, and preparation for the coming holidays. It is a time more than marking a 2,000-year-old history. It is celebrating in truth about God, the revelation of God in Christ Jesus, whereby all of creation might be reconciled back to God. That is a process in which we now participate. We know that people have really lately gone away from God. But this is a time when we need to come back to God. Today's passage yet reminds us that there is yet a second Advent looming in the horizon. The doctrine of the second coming of Jesus is one of the central doctrines of the Christian faith. When we come to take the bread and cup, the liturgy reminds us of a confession that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. So today, on this first week of Advent, I want to talk on the subject, ready or not, here I come. Ready or not, here I come. Well, I want to remind us that Jesus is coming back, but no one knows the day or the hour. Now, remember back in the day, and most of us probably remember that day when we could play outside. And we didn't have all of the technology that we have now, but it was fun. It was fun to be able to go outside and play, and it's kind of difficult to do that now. But there was a game that we used to play. How many played that game? Hide and seek. Hide and seek. Yes. The game when someone would cover their eyes and begin counting 5, 10, 15, 20, and so on. giving all the others a chance to run and hide. Then the seeker would announce, "Ready or not, here I come." And that means if you haven't had a chance to fully secure your hiding place, and if you were found, then you were tagged it. That game reminds me of the second advent of Jesus, a situation that this entire world faces, and many will try to go and hide, but unfortunately, there will be no place to hide for those who are not ready. In our text, Jesus tells the things that will happen in the parousia, his second coming. It says, "In those days after suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not shed its light. The stars will be falling from heaven and the powers of heaven will shake. Then the people of the earth will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out his angels with a loud trumpet, and Jesus will gather the elect." Thank you, Jesus. He'll gather us, those who believe in him. Gather us from the four winds, from one end of the sky to the other. And I believe he's saying in his heart, "Ready or not, here I come." It will be quick, not even a 2-minute warning. And we must be ready. But again, we don't know the day or the hour, for God's timing is not our timing. His time, our timing is chronos, chronological time. But God's timing is kairos, time, where 1 minute can be 1,000 years. But it is also where destiny meets. Jesus, in his very pivotal verse, says, "Beware, keep alert." You don't know when the time will come. No one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. So in my assignment today is to remind you, ready or not, here he will come. And this time, it won't be to save as it was on the first time. He came the first time to save us. But this time when he comes to judge us. And so we have to be ready. And the Bible says there will be a set of many conditions which will precede the parousia, the coming of the Son of Man with glory and dominion from the Ancient of Days and the end of the age. But there will be many trials and tribulations that inevitably precede the great day or period. All antecedent signs will appear, cosmic, natural, social, political, and religious signs. And we've seen some of those already. So Jesus counsels watchfulness, vigilance, a constant sense of urgency, but not necessarily a state of emergency, because the only wise thing to do in this unpredictable yet inevitable closing of an age and the coming of Christ Jesus is to be careful, be ready. Because it may not happen when we see all of these negative conditions that's becoming more intense, with seeming evidence, with false messiahs erroneously announcing the end. And we must not be gullible, no matter how great and compelling it seems, and believe every prediction Notwithstanding the very fact that most will be caught unawares, we must be in constant readiness and not become complacent, or worse, not believe it, because the end has not yet come, or because it has been loudly and confidently predicted many times, but not happened. For I hear Jesus still saying, ready or not, here I come. And in Matthew 24, Jesus gave three parables. The first was, it will be like Noah's generation. They were so immersed in the ordinary, everyday pursuits of eating and drinking and marrying, but no thought for spiritual things. They were nonchalant about God and blind to the imminent disaster. To God for his life and believing in his word and his personal righteousness that caused him to see that no one else at that time could see Noah. We're talking about Noah. He saw and he believed something that no one else believed, even though he would tell them what was going to happen. And the floodwaters quickly came without warning, and everyone perished in the flood except Noah and his family. Yes, they were forewarned. They were forewarned for doing 120 years. It took Noah to build the ark. He was calling on the people for repentance, but they probably felt that Noah was a fanatic, so only Noah and his family were saved. Then Jesus said, it will be like two men in the field. One will be taken and the other will be left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken and the other will be left. Ready or not, Jesus will come. It is the rapture of the faithful followers at the time of his second coming. He says, we will be immediately taken up to heaven as our reward. But the unfaithful will be left behind, a hellish state and fate. I really hate preaching this kind of sermon. But oh my siblings, we can't afford to be casual about this. There is too much at stake. There is too much to be won and too much to lose. When the warning sounds, we must be living for God with all of our strength, drawing nearer to God. And like I said last week, wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in Jesus, making sure that our loved ones are also in the ark of safety, the church, studying the word of God, having a relationship with him. And it is not a time for the child of God to be casual or lackadaisical or half-stepping. We need to be ready and to stay ready. But when we look at all of the terrible things that we are seeing today, the unprecedented pandemic, all of the hate that is going around, the increase of killings all over the place, and in churches, in schools, in supermarkets, everywhere. And then the wars and rumors of wars in the Middle East and other places, Ukraine, and all of the Earth's atmospheric conditions, hurricanes in strange places, tornadoes in places that they have never been before. It is interesting, when God gets ready to do something, though, he always forewarns us prior to the intervention by signs and signals that are designed to prepare us for what he's getting ready to do. But not only did he warn us before, But he is warning us now. And as I said, it may not happen in our lifetime, but the signs of the time are increasing and increasing and increasing. But when he warned them, before he sent the flood with the ark as a sign, before the Lord delivered the Israelites from the Egyptian bondage, he sent 10 plagues upon the Egyptians as signs. In Isaiah, King Ahaz received a sign of the Lord's presence. A young woman bearing a child to be named Emmanuel received a sign of the birth of Jesus. Not only that, there were signs in the heavens and in the earth, and the stars shone in the heavens, the choirs of angels sang, and the shepherds received the word from the angel, "This shall be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And at the end of Jesus' life, darkness covered the whole earth, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two as sign of his death. And just as the first coming of Jesus was preceded with signs, so will the second coming be preceded with signs. That is why Advent is a season that looks in the two directions at the same time. We look backward to the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem, but we also look forward to the time when Jesus will return to earth to set up his kingdom. So living our lives in such a way, we won't be caught off guard if that day were to be soon or even today. Is crucial. But how do we do this in the 21st century lifestyle when our days are filled with overflowing obligations and responsibilities? How can we find time when everything seems to crowd out our thoughts of the spiritual side of life to the point where we think it is optional with all of the other priorities and obligations we have, especially this time of year? Maybe after the rush season, there will be time to concentrate or thinking about reading the Bible or praying or going to Bible study in church. We may not be ready for Christmas, and frankly, not ready for Jesus either. Many will say, "I used to go to Sunday school and church. I heard the Bible stories when I was growing up, but I just got out of the habit." Advent season is a special time, a sign in the Christian calendar to slow down for reflection. Know how to be prepared if Jesus should come today and break through our lives unexpectedly. Fear and uncertainty was present in Jesus' time, and today's scripture sounds just like it came right up this week's news headlines. World leaders are not in agreement as how to go about solving the problems in the Middle East. Terrorists abroad and even homegrown terrorists. Folks can't be safe anywhere. So Isaiah's desire, as was read by Sister Kathy, his desire was for God to reveal himself once again to us. For Isaiah, God must appear. The great Advent hymn reveals the desire of Isaiah and the people of all times for God to look up to God. Oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captured Israel that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appears. Advent is a time of expectation, anticipation. We're celebrating the fact that Jesus came into the world over 2,000 years ago and dwells in the hearts of those who believe and has caused us to be born again, becoming new creations, children of God, and that Jesus will come back again to usher in God's kingdom. Kingdom. It will be his kingdom as well. All of us, loving as we are in this church, in all of its fullness. Isaiah said, oh, that he would split the heavens and come down. The mountains would tremble before us. He is speaking on behalf of a people who are powerless and oppressed. He addresses it in the form of a prayer which contains the hope of Advent, of how God came in the past, and he is waiting for God to come again. Then the question is, how then can we be saved? That is a good question. As the prophet surveys this situation, he lowers his voice and he confesses the guilt of the nation. For Israel sinned and was unclean. For the church to really experience Advent, there must be a genuine confession. For we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So there always must be a confession and repentance. And you know, repentance is turning away. Turning away from whatever is holding us back. Jesus comes in our heart when we confess our sin and repent. And in order to be ready for the second coming of Christ, we must confess our sin and repent. Confession is a clearinghouse for us to seek the mercy of God. True confession washes away the arrogance of thinking that we can save ourselves. Advent comes each year to judge us and to remind us that we are all sinners. Advent answers the question that Isaiah asked and reminds us that our own efforts to save ourselves leaves us as filthy rags, contaminated and impure. In our own strength, we are like leaves, faded and vulnerable, that will be blown away. If you don't get anything else I say today, Jesus came the first time as a baby in a manger to save us, but when he comes again, he's coming to judge the world. He will be in a heavenly state in his full glory, so all the people will see him and be brought to their knees in reverence and awe. Everybody will be brought to their knees. We must be ready. We must have Jesus in our hearts, our minds, our spirit, our souls. And Jesus is saying, ready or not, here I come. So how do we get ready for Christmas? Let our gospel lesson for this morning set the stage for us. Jesus says, at that time, folks will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory, and no one will be able to deny his presence. And he will send his angels to gather the elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Ready or not, he will come. And praise God, he does say help is on the way. So in trouble or perplexing times, I've got hope. In sickness or sorrow, I've got hope. In distress or in hard times, I have hope. In dark days, I have hope. Why? Because we will be abundantly blessed. to enjoy a perfect world, ruled by only the righteous ruler who has ever existed, the Son of God, the only begotten Son of the Father, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Ready or not, here he comes. Amen. It will be a time where, as Christians and as those who confess Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, we don't have to worry. And that's why it is so important that we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. I'm so glad that on our first Sunday here, when we gave the call to salvation, someone stood up and said, I have never said that. And so the whole church became saved. So there may be someone who is watching, or someone maybe even here, who has not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, you shall be saved. It's just a matter of believing. It's not about works. But you will do work because you want to do everything that you can for the cause of Christ. So if there's anyone under the sound of my voice, it may be online, if you do that simple prayer and confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior, saying something simple like, Jesus, I confess that I'm a sinner. Now I want to change my life. And I believe that you lived and you died and you rose from the dead. And now I want you to come into my heart and my mind and my spirit. And I promise that I will serve you for the rest of my life. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for forgiving me. Thank you for giving me your great salvation. If you have prayed that simple prayer, the word says you are saved. Now you need to find a church home where you can work out your own salvation with loving people. I always say this is a small church, but it's a loving church. In all the churches that I've been, I've never witnessed a church as loving as this. And so we welcome you to Fair Oaks United Methodist Church. You can call us at 916-961-6631, and we will pray with you, we will lead you and guide you in the way. We look forward to hearing from you. In Jesus' name. Amen. This is a time where we get an opportunity to share of our substance. God says, freely give, freely receive. The Lord loves a cheerful giver. Will the ushers come? Thank you. check from the Andrews family for Alma's service, $500. Father God, we thank you for these gifts and offerings to be used for the upbuilding of our church and kingdom. Bless the givers, oh God. Bless those who wanted but were unable to. And Father God, we ask that you will multiply these gifts, 101,000 fold, multiply also in our own personal coffers. And we'll be so thankful and so careful to give you the praise and the honor and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God say amen. Father God, Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to share the Holy Communion. We ask, oh God, that you become infused in us, oh God. We ask, oh God, that you will fill us with your glory as we partake of these elements. We ask, oh God, that you will instill upon us hope. Hope in you. Bless, oh God, these elements. Touch in the name of Jesus. Touch this congregation, oh God. Each and every person, you know every need. And so fill us, oh God, with all that you have. And we'll be so thankful and so careful to give you the praise and the honor and the glory. In Jesus' name. It was on that very fateful night that Jesus was betrayed. He gathered his disciples together for their last supper.
And so after supper, he took the bread and he broke it.
And after giving thanks, thank you, Jesus. He gave it to his disciples. And he said, take, eat. This is my body, which was broken for you. Do this as often as you come together in remembrance of me. After supper, he also took of the cup. And he blessed the cup. Thank you, Jesus, for this precious blood. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, for as often as you do eat of this bread, you do drink of this cup until my coming again. And let us rise together as we take the communion, as after everyone is saved, eat and drink. Yeah. Having made your humble confession to Almighty God, you may rise, my Father's children, go in peace and sin no more. And as they depart, let others come, meekly kneeling on your knees, making your humble confession to Almighty God. Open communion. All who accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior are welcome. Precious. precious blood that was shed for you, for the preservation of your body unto everlasting life. Having made your humble confession to Almighty God, you may rise, my Father's children, go in peace and sin no more. And as they depart, let others come meekly kneeling on your knees, making your humble confession to Almighty God. Having made your humble confession to Almighty God, you may rise, my Father's children, go in peace, and sin no more. And as they depart, are there others? Has everyone been saved, been served?
Saved,
yeah. Has everyone been saved? Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Amen, amen. Praise God. We praise God for your presence, and we pray God's divine blessings upon you. And bless you, 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 and bless you.
And bless you.
Blessings upon each and every one of us in the name of Jesus. And we claim it and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.